Saturday. We stopped, I think, here. Then stops matrix. So today we start with the next part of matrix measurement, that is Porter's five forces. I think you have studied this in strategic management. Whether you have studied this for the in the third semester, whether you had this. Five forces. Hello. Now, which consists of five components. These five forces, an organization, a company, can take into consideration the performance of the company, how the company is performing. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, here if you see the bargaining power of buyers is there. Now here, what do you understand by the bargaining power of buyers? Now we are speaking this from the industry perspective or the company perspective. Now there are many factors. Are to be considered here when we consider the bargain. Now, who are these? Maybe the companies. Okay. Customers here. Now, the bargaining power of these buyers depend upon the customers, that is the demand for the product. Now if you consider those customers who are pro towards technology driven products, that is irrespective of any price, they are ready to purchase. So we say such type of buyers there means there is as far as the demand of elasticity is considered, it is inelastic or non-sensitive, irrespective of the prices moving here and there, the people would like to purchase the product. They don't care for the pricing. So those products which are on quality based, okay. So a certain set of customer is there who will care more for the quality as compared to the pricing attribute. Now, where does this pricing will matter? For the convenience goods or the goods which you buy on day-to-day basis. If the price of that increases, then there is a problem. Now here, the increase in the price of sugar, the increase in the price of the milk, whatever it is, nobody is left out with it. Nobody can think of having any substitutes. People do purchase, but when it is a luxurious goods or the goods which come into the categories of non-convenience, then there is an option for the customers whether to purchase it or what they will do. They will think of postponing the decision of buying it. Similarly, same is the case in terms of the industrial purchasers. Suppose if the buyers are more and the suppliers are few, then these suppliers have an advantage in quoting the prices. The buyers are many and the suppliers are very less. So here they have their own competitive advantage, this as far as the suppliers are considered. Now we are simultaneously discussing the bargaining power of buyers as well as the suppliers here, both the perspectives. What is the size of each customer? Similarly, when the company manufactures a product, okay, of a good quality, or of maybe their products are in more demand, so here the company has that competitive edge. Even though the prices are high, even though maybe they may have the competitors, but because of certain differentiation, people want to purchase the same product. If the competitor enters with the same thing, then there is a problem for the existing organization or the industry. It is a threat then here. So here one has to take into consideration the price sensitivity aspect as far as the bargaining power of buyers is considered. That is the first and foremost thing. This again depends upon the type. Now suppose if you consider the medicines, okay, for the patients, doctor refers certain medicines. Here the patient cannot say that maybe I will purchase it later on. No, it is an essential goods. It has to be bought irrespective of price range. One cannot say that I would like to postpone, isn't it? So here price sensitivity depends on the category of goods or services. Wherever the goods are essential, wherever they are needed, there irrespective of increase and decrease in the prices, the people are going to purchase it. So those companies which are into such type of industries, there is less threat. Only the threat is from the competitors. Okay, here it's not going to happen suddenly that customers will not purchase the product. They are going to purchase because these are mandatory or essential goods. So similarly, from the supplier's point of view, the same thing applies. So here, I was speaking about the suppliers, if there are few suppliers and more of the customers, the organizations, the companies producing a particular good or an offering, they are more in number as compared to the suppliers. These suppliers will have an upper edge in deciding the benchmark, whom to cater. That is controlling of demand. Controlling of demand in the sense that it depends upon them whether they want to cater to the bulk orders or whether they want to restrict to particular organization, or they want to give equal chance to all the organizations in the market. Since the buyers are, since the sellers are very few. Now here it's the buyer's ability to substitute. That is one more point here. Suppose if the buyer finds, the companies find that the suppliers are very less in number, so they are having the added advantage. Against this, the buyer can think of having some substitute options. This is possible in metallic industries, where there is a substitute. Substitute is available. The substitutable options are available. The company starts thinking about the different options. What are the alternative options for the existing system, for the existing scenario? The buyers should also seek information about the availability of goods, about the new options, also about new suppliers, whether there are any new suppliers, whether these things can be imported from other countries, whether it will be feasible, whether it will be profitable. So these are some of the questions which are taken into consideration here. Also, there are switching costs. So here, those industries which come under the purview of government tax or rules and regulations, they do have the frequent ups and downs, where the pricing is dependent upon the regulations, regulatory framework. So there this cost will switch. Now here what the supplier will say, we did not get the material, or maybe as the resources are pooled, the cost increases. So here this switching cost is a major challenge for the organizations as far as this power of buyers is considered. Now coming to the next part, that is the trade of substitutes. Now here when we consider the threat of substitutes, the number and size of suppliers do matter, whether they are few or they are more. Suppose if the buyers are less and the suppliers are more, then there is no problem. So here the advantage is for the buyers. So in this case, there is always a threat for these suppliers. Suppose you have a customer who is very loyal customer, for years the supplier is supplying, but if some other suppliers comes with a better option and pricing, naturally this firm is going to get attracted by those options, and there is a possibility that they may lose the tie up with the existing supplier. Second is uniqueness of each supplier's product. Unless and until the supplier is committed with certain differentiation strategies, certain uniqueness, there is less possibility of tying up of the both the parties. If they have something unique to offer, maybe out of the way, if they are helping the companies. Many a times there are critical incidences when you know the raw material is in short, or maybe the supply is in short, but in spite of these critical problems, the supplier tries to see to it that the goods reach the end customers. So that is noted by the organizations. In this unique case, the organization will not directly or easily think of jumping to a new supplier. Also, the company's policies do matter here. Whether they can adapt the substitute product and how they can inculcate, that is also very important here. How the buyer feels with the context of substitute matters a lot. Whether that substitute will help maintain the position of the company in the market is very important. And again, there is a important thing, that is pricing. When the company thinks of a substitute, again, pricing is one of the important factor. The people should not perceive this level of product as a differentiation from the original product. Because of the switching cost, they should not feel that the manufacturer has just force them with some substitute product. That should not happen here, because the market share is important for all the organizations. Now the threat of new entrants is also a problem. First and foremost thing is the barriers to entry. If there are less barriers, more companies can enter into the market very easily. But if there are certain barriers, certain checks are there, then there is a possibility of no entrance. Now that too, it depends upon the innovativeness of the competitor. Whether the company has come up with the new something novel in its offering, then it's a possibility that the product will click or the services will click. So it's a threat for the existing organizations. This new entrant may eat the share of the existing organizations. Second thing is the economies of the scale. For this new entrant, okay, to reach to the economies of the scale phase, it needs some time. So the other companies should think and come up with the different strategies so as to maintain their market share as well as to maintain the economies of the scale part. The brand loyalty of the customers again is a challenge for the existing companies. When the new company enters, there is a possibility that the customers might switch over from this company to some other new entrant. There are also the capital requirements for a new entrant. Okay, when the product is into the market, it's into the market for the first time, more of the investments they are spent for promotional aspects, promotion through advertising, mass media, social media, the push through intermediaries like the dealers and the distributors. Even they have to be given the margins so that they push the product in the market. Against this, since the competitor has entered, even the existing companies, they will also have to be on toes and try to push their products. They will also have to spend their investments here. Again, there are certain government policies which the companies have to take care of. Even the new entrant has to take care of the pricing strategies about the ingredients which they have used. They have to adhere to the norms of the government. For the new entrant, thinks about the, if they want to enter into existing distribution channels, already with these channels they may have the competitor's product, so they have to think of alternative channels to reach to the masses. If the distributor has gained much of the reputation, then there is no problem. But if the distributor is again new, coming with the new product, so here convincing the customers becomes a problem. So unless and until they adjust themselves, they cope up with all these factors, there is a gap. And this gap, in this gap, the existing company should immediately react and come up with the alternative strategies so as to protect their market share. Now here there is also a rivalry among the competitors. How many competitors are there? Now here again it depends upon the sector. If it is a niche market, very less, one or two competitors. If it is segmented, then you will have more competition, more competitors. If it is with reference to industrial buying and purchasing of goods, there are again less customers. If it is a generic good of any category of FMCG, then there are more competitors. So here it depends upon the type of goods. Again, the companies, whether they are diversified, the diversity of competitors matters a lot. If the two competitors, they don't match, okay, if one of them is having six products which do not map with the other competitor having six again their products, and both of them they have their market share, then there is no problem. But if both of them have intermingled, then the market share, there is a problem as far as acquiring the market share is considered. Now here again, the growth stage of these industries, it matters, the market growth stage as well as the product growth stage. Whether the product is in the growth stage or the introduction stage, or it's towards the end of the growth stage and entering into the decline stage. So here, apart from this, the quality difference, okay, visible quality difference also matters. Many a times there are intangible attributes which are linked to a product, which are not directly visible by the competitors. So in this case, it becomes difficult for the competitor to enter the markets. They have to have their own formulas. Also, the company which thinks of liquidation or divestment, what are the barriers to exit? That is again a problem here for many of the companies. Whether they can quit directly or there are problems with the reference to the investments. Because here the liquidation of machinery is not again an easy task. Now this was about the Fortress 5 forces. Now coming to the next metrics. Whether this PPT is visible? Market profitability analysis. See, now you have studied this.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, in the strategic management you have studied this, isn't it? Now it's from the marketing point of view. There you might have studied from the generalized point of view. Here this is with reference to strategic decisions with respect to marketing angle. Now coming to the next part, it is the market profitability analysis. Now, as the name says, the major crux is the profitability. And the foundation for this matrix is the relationship with customers. Now, here today we say the customer is the king. As the customers purchase the product, the companies are receiving the profits. The more the company thinks of penetrating into the market, more it will be close to the customers and possibility of gaining more market share is possible here. Now, profitability analysis is an analysis of cost and revenue of the firm which determine whether or not the firm is profiting, whether actually the profits are coming or not. So here we have seen even the penetration strategy, market skimming strategy, isn't it? One aspect is enter into the market with a higher price and gain the profit. Second thing is market penetration, where you lower down the price and increase the market share. So vice versa, it's going to have the profits. Because if you go for the other decision of lowering down the price and entering the market, then in that case, you will have more market shares, which will help in gaining the economies of the scale for the companies. So in this case, customer is the focus. The basic ideology here is to satisfy the customer needs, customer satisfaction, so that he can go for the repeat purchase and becomes a loyal customer for the organization. Now, a component of enterprise resource planning, that is ERP, allows administrators to forecast the profitability of optimum profit. So this helps an organization to discover things like which customers are least profitable, which are more profitable, who should be served better. So here we can say the category of customers are taken into consideration. It helps discern which product or services generate the least amount of revenue. It seeks to understand the customer base. The company basically would like to meet its profitability objectives. Now, profitability analysis helps in a better or larger scope. It has much more larger scope. It looks at individual customer as a profit gaining center. So more of the time spent on the customer needs, understanding them, the more the income you receive. Especially this is applicable in the service sector, where word of mouth publicity matters a lot. Because of the intangible factor associated with the services, this is more applicable there. Now, to gain the profit share to satisfy the customers, here the companies have to spend a lot of amount of the profit to create awareness through advertising, through promotion, through social media approach. Their investments mostly are stuck up in this advertising part, that is reaching to the customers. What the customers thinks, what are their opinions, views, what is their feedback, that is more important. So basically here, based upon this, there is a profit analysis. So they use the Pareto's principle, that is concentrate on those customers who give you more profitability or revenues. So better you serve those customers, though they are less, but loyal customers, try to serve them and be on the forefront as far as the profit aspect or revenue generation aspect is considered here. That's why today, if you see most of the companies, they go for the personalized or customized approach. If you see the services like tour and travels, the banking industries, the insurance, even for the durables, this is applicable because of the competition. Now, a simple thing, maybe if you have taken an insurance policy, okay, you might have come across many of the messages popping in on your mobile, or they send you the mail regarding the reminder maybe of the premium or newly introduced or launched any service, okay, any package which they have introduced. Same is for tours and travels. If they have come up with a new scheme for the tours and travels, if they are offering the discount, any information, if you see, the companies see to it that these information reaches the end customers. Now, why do the companies have to strive so hard to reach the customers, make the customers aware about the new schemes launched? Because everybody wants to grab the customers today. And just not grabbing the customers is the objective, but by satisfying their needs, if they gain profits, that is more appreciated nowadays. Because, you know, just focusing on the profitability might not be a long-term goal. So here today, if you see that focus on needs of the customers and then move ahead, that is the better option. Now, this is applicable to many companies who were, now if you have seen recently in the news, the companies, okay, those who offer actually seen as a junk food manufacturers, many of them, whether you have heard about this, they are also changing the focus or shifting the focus from this, you know, so-called, from the perception of the customers, so-called junk food to the nutritional food. They are thinking from this perspective. The customer should not feel that we are offering the junk food. There should be some value addition to the component to the product offered. That is what is the emphasis being thought of. Now here, basically, the focus as far as this market profitability analysis is on 3 points. The customer profitability analysis, which calculates revenues coming from customers as compared to its costs. It helps in calculation per unit cost and per customer also, increasing the profitability with the increase in the competitive advantage is also thought of, and also implementation of the TQM techniques, that is the emphasis on total quality management, not just offering the product, but emphasis on the quality. Now the next part is family portfolio metrics. Now we have seen in the previous session the BCG metrics, where we had question marks, stars, cash cows and dogs. There were 4 quadrants, isn't it? So this family portfolio matrix is an extension of BCG matrix. Now here in the BCG matrix, we have seen the four quadrants. Here, isn't it? The question marks are there, the stars are there, the dogs are there, the stars are there. Now, no model is left out without its advantages as well as the other sign is the drawbacks. So similarly here, BCG matrix, in spite of having many advantages, here it is felt that by marketers that there is no consideration as far as the risk factor is considered. When new markets are created and have a low initial rate of growth, the products will be shown as cash cows or dogs, when this might not be the case. Okay. Also, market attractiveness is measured by use of growth rates, which may not be a robust enough measure on its own. Now, these growth rates vary, and these alone do not show future potential within the market. They change. And now we have seen as the product moves through PLCs, different product life cycles, or with reference to external factors acting upon it, there are certain fluctuations, but this matrix does not consider that. And that's why in this family portfolio matrix, we can see the extension of it. Now here, if you see this figure, there are new considerations to the previous one. Here, these are again divided. They are divided into the cells. Like we have the problem children, the rising stars, cash cows, dogs, war horses, dodos, research and development. So there are different matrices here. Now, Leeds Metropolitan University published a conference paper which extended this BCG matrix to this, which gives an elaborate idea of having more specific quadrants or cells with reference to different situations, maybe with reference to profitability and market share, with reference to different product life cycles the product is moving through. So on the basis of this, certain quadrants were suggested, like the infants, where you have the new products, okay, which generate the cash for low spend. They have low market growth rate and medium high market share. The growth is low, but if you see the market share slowly and steadily, they may have medium market share. Similarly, ideas and concepts. These are products that are in development. So ideas and concepts, they are into research and development, new to the market. People are not aware about these new ideas or new concepts. Here the spending or the investments from the company side is more because they have spent a lot on this research and development and coming up with the innovative offering to the customers. Similarly, research and development, if you see that quadrant, it's a high potential market growth rate, but they are yet to be placed on the market. Here also, more spending is done on the offering. And initially, you cannot think of having a market share also and profitability also. It is going to eat up companies' major investments as far as this research and development cell is considered. There are hibernating squirrels who are withdrawn from the market but may be returned to the market at a later date. Now here, maybe for some time they are withdrawn. Maybe they are polished. Okay, again they enter the market. So this is known as a hibernating squirrels. Now here some of the companies, they withdraw. Maybe they would like to take some time and make a scope for some new product. Okay. Now here this is possible when there is a threat of the existing brand getting diluted. If some other brand enters and both are on the similar lines, the companies think of withdrawing the parent brand and allowing the new flanker product to enter in the market. Once it acquires the market share, again the parent brand is introduced slowly and steadily. People also don't come to know whether it's there, it was there or not. So these are the invisible aspects or invisible strategies here by the companies. Basically, those companies who have more competitors think of coming up with the or adapting such a strategy where you have more product line very closely related as well as more number of competitors. You can take like soaps or toothpaste where you have very closely related product lines of a company. And there is a cutthroat competition also. Now, war horses, these are the products with high relative market share but negative growth rate. So here, when you have the negative growth rate, that means it's towards the decline stage. Here, the companies can think of just offering the products at a lower cost or entering into the pockets where the competitor is not there and just collecting the money, whatever is there, just wind up, before winding up the business, think of having more profits, collection of money before leaving the market. So here the prices are decreased. Only aspect is to enter the market, to penetrate the market and grab the profits, not the market share actually, but whatever money this brand or product can gain. So here, make the money most out of it and leave the market. That is what it means. The dodos, the products with no market share and negative market growth rate. Those who are highly on the divestment, on the road of divestment, those companies undertake these activities, this strategy I mean. The next is the lingering memories. Now these are the products which have long been removed from the market but still resonate in the mind of the consumers. Now here, why this has been considered? Many of you might still remember the brands which are not there in the market, which do not exist, but still we can't recall them easily. Now here, many of the companies can think of relaunching it with the same brand. Some of the customers who were satisfied with those products and maybe because of the competition or maybe because of the government restrictions, the companies moved out of the market, they can diversify and they can use the same brand name. They can enter into the market with the same brand name. So customers associate them that these are the manufacturer of those products. And ultimately, they link the goodwill, the quality of the product to the newly entered company. So here, this is about the measurement or metrics. Maybe in the next session, we will discuss the further part. Now, any doubts here? So we will stop here today.